Rock Hard Radio 1 presents... From New York City, Rock Hard with Jay Conroy.
All right, welcome back to Rock Hard with Jay Conroy on RockHardRadio1.com from New York City. As promised, in the studio, a couple of the guys from DareDevil Squadron. Introduce yourself, guys.
This is Angus Clark. I play guitar for DareDevil Squadron.
This is Aurelian Buddyneck. I play guitar also for DareDevil Squadron.
All right, I'm going to start off by reading your bio here, which I found very interesting. I'm just going to read this here. DareDevil Squadron rocks with a vengeance and won't quit until they've shown the world what a five-man band can do. Armed with some of the finest songs written in this or any genre, the Squadron combines virtuosity with finesse in order to create an emotional impact on the listener unrivaled by their contemporaries. Substantive and reliable lyrics that draw you in and captivate you. Memorable melodies and rhythmic hooks that stick in your head for days. The sound of rock music as it was meant to be played. Loud! Like that. The members of DDS are all at the top of their game. Andrew Ross is a singer who has the raw intensity of a young Paul Di'Anno, which I did notice listening to that, with more rage and control. Interesting. Guitarist Angus Clark and Aurelian, how do I say your last
name? Buddyneck.
Buddyneck, that's actually pretty easy. Playing lockstep with each other, whether it's on rhythm parts or hyper speed lead lines. With differing yet complementary solo styles, this is a guitar duo that will stand up against Tipton and Downing, or L.I. and Topman. Bassist Chris, how do I pronounce Chris's last name?
Altenhoff
and drummer Jason Gianni. Yeah. Hold it all together, keeping the groove even in the oddest of time signatures. It was in the back lounge of a tour bus, with an early Iron Maiden concert DVD playing in the background, that Angus, Andrew, and Chris first discussed the future of the new wave, the next new wave of British heavy... The future of the next new wave of British-inspired American heavy metal, or simply... What's that mean?
That was our play on, you know, the rock press coined the new wave of British heavy metal, the NWOBHM.
Uh-huh.
And that was, I think it started with, I don't know if Saxon was lumped in there because they were earlier, but, you know, definitely Iron Maiden and everybody that followed in the wake with, you know, twin guitar leads and all that intense, you know, the really dramatic singers and, you know, that whole sound was called the new wave of British heavy metal.
Mm-hmm.
And because we were inspired by that, we were hoping to popularize a new acronym, the next new wave of British-inspired American heavy metal, the NWOBIAHM.
It's catchy.
It is catchy. It didn't really take off, particularly because of the conversation we're having right now.
Yeah, well, you know, if you push it long enough, you never know. You know, that's the way it is. Sometimes ideas take a while to come on. Now, I'm looking down here, and I got to ask about this at the risk of asking about it. It says The Pilots, lead vocals Andrew Ross, call sign Awesome Wolf, guitar Angus Clark, call sign, Rogue. Guitar, Aurelian Buddyneck, call sign, Bordeaux Bandit. Bass, Chris, what is Chris's last name?
Altenhoff.
Okay, call sign, Thunderball. And drums, James, call sign, El Torino. What the fuck is that all about?
Well,
we're having some fun with the whole notion of the squadron being pilots.
Sure.
And if you recall from, and this is an actual military thing, but I think most of us ever learned about it by watching the movie Top Gun.
Uh-huh.
So everybody had a call sign. You know, Tom Cruise's was Maverick, and Val Kilmer's was Iceman, and Goose was the co-pilot to Tom Cruise, and his replacement was Merlin, so on and so forth. And so we were just having some fun with that, and you know, they're just all something that we just wanted to have done, and we have fun with it. It's not, we're, you know, we're equally capable of having a good time laughing at audacity in rock as we are completely respectful of it. Like, I'm never gonna, you know, say I don't love Paul Di'Anno on those first couple of Maiden records, but I will also say that, man, there's some corny stuff in there, right? Every now and then, it's like you have a good time with this music. That's the whole point.
Right.
You're having a good time with it.
Well, you have a sense of humor.
Yes,
I like
exactly.
that. The band's got to have a band that takes themselves so seriously. It's kind of like, all right. Now, speaking of that, I see that you guys, and I think Aurelian, we had talked about this, that you guys got a song on the new iPhone video game Top Gun 2. Speaking
yes.
of Top Gun, now don't tell me. Because looking at this, I'm thinking to myself, I wonder what it is. And, you know, I was listening to the album over and over last night, and I said, well, it's got to be one of two songs. It's got to be either, and don't tell me yes or no.
Which
yet,
is it, Jay?
Hero Falls, or was I going to say Forgotten Son? Is it either one of those?
I think Forgotten Son is in there. Which one was
in
there?
So there's more than one in there.
Power Trip's on there.
Power Trip's
on there.
And Forgotten Son's on there.
Son's on there too. The driving, all the real driving rhythm stuff.
The fast ones.
So you got more than one song on there.
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't know that.
The whole soundtrack is us, and then Danger Zone.
Or is Danger Zone on there?
Yeah.
Or the Top Gun theme is
the
on
Top
there
Gun,
for
the
sure.
The Steve Stevens thing.
Run into the Danger Zone. That one.
Yeah.
Kenny Loggins classic.
Yeah. Well. Yeah. All right. We're gonna once again. We are in the studio with DareDevil Squadron on Rock Hard with Jay Conroy on RockHardRadio1.com from New York City. Now, the name of the album is Out of the Sun, correct?
Yes.
And
correct.
That is a badass lead-off track that I actually hear some Maiden in. So I want to get right to that, the lead-off track from DareDevil Squadron. Song is called Out of the Sun. Check this out, this rocks.
Out of the sun. Wipe the sweat from has filled your mask, you're choking on your tears. Bandits falling all around, the day will soon be ours. Wreckage on the fields below, you join the other cowards right now. There can be no turning back, we go.
Go!
Daredevil Squadron attack! Oh, now you'd better pray. Oh, face your dying day, nowhere to run when we come diving out of the sun.
Out of the Sun, Daredevil Squadron. Tell me about the influence for that song.
This is Angus. The whole story about us watching an old Iron Maiden video is absolutely true. We've watched this documentary called Iron Maiden: The Early Years, and it has. It's if you haven't seen it, it is awesome. It is like one of the best. Like just films about bands I've ever seen. They have everybody that was in Iron Maiden up through Number of the Beast, from its inception until Number of the Beast,
wow.
Comes together at the Cart and Horses, the club where they played their first gig, and it's like 40 guys, and almost all of them.
There was that many members in Maiden?
It's insane, and
damn.
They were just about all. Fired by Steve Harris at some point.
Really?
That's what's awesome about it. And they all still respect him. They're all like, oh, yeah, he can be, but I deserved it, you know.
Yeah, right.
It's like that. So,
yeah, when the camera's on.
Yeah, so, yeah.
Behind it, like, that fucker cost me a career. Yeah.
So, we're watching that. We're talking about doing this thing. And I actually had a good portion of that track, the riffs and stuff, from a few years back, and I just had never found the right guys to play it with. It's one of those things, you know, like you have a career, you play in different bands, you come up with riffs, you come up with material, and you're just like, it's just not anything I can do with it because I don't have a band of guys that want to do this kind of material, that kind of material. And when this came together, I was just like, man, I gotta pull that riff back up.
Yeah.
This is the right band for that thing, and we got it. It was one of the first things we had when we brought Jason in to play drums, and it was all about if he could do that like medium fast double kick drum thing, which is like, it's a muscular tempo for a drummer because you really got to lay into the kicks at that tempo and stuff like that. It's very Cozy Powell influenced,
mm-hmm.
Which is a massive, huge influence for me. Like Cozy Powell and his work in Rainbow, well, all of his work, but specifically in Rainbow.
Yeah.
Very Kill the King. There's a lot of Kill the King in this song, I think, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was heavy into Rainbow. Loved Rainbow.
Yes, you were. Of course.
Yeah.
And so then, so Jason was nailing it on that, and that was awesome. And then we had to come up with the lyrical thing working with Andrew. This was like Andrew and I sitting in this rehearsal space on 8th Avenue, you know, in the music building on 8th Avenue,
mm-hmm.
584, sitting in there working on, you know, lyrics that were about a dogfight. And, We kept coming up with stuff that was going to really feel good for him to sing and dig into. And then Aurelian and I came together on what are we going to do to make this a two-guitar thing? And that's where the whole harmony, so there's a whole harmony solo in there that we kind of see as being like planes flying in formation with each other.
Right.
Now, let me backtrack for a second because, you know, as we read in the bio... you're in the back of a tour bus watching, you know, the DVD and that sort of thing. So from there, when did the band really come together? When did you finalize all the players and said, you know what, this is it, we're going to go do this? Was it that night in the tour bus? How long after the tour bus before things really got going?
It was a series of phone calls.
It always is.
Actually, it was a text message for me. I didn't get the phone call, but I got the text message.
What it was, it was like, here's news. You're in a band now.
it was something like that. It was I forget exactly how it was worded, but it was something like, do you want to be in a classic hard rock band with me and Andrew? Something like that. And, you know, and then I said yes.
And there it was.
That was it. And that was, you know, that was the band.
And what year was that?
I believe I got that text in late 2008.
Okay.
Sounds right.
Yeah.
And when did you guys actually sit down and record this?
We recorded this, well, we started, you know, the band got finalized at the end of 2008. We started rehearsing and, you know, finished writing and collaborating in 2009. And we recorded this album in the fall of 2009.
Yeah. Late 2009. My daughter was like 5 months old, and I literally like wound up on daddy duty one day that I had to go in and approve some drum edits or something, and I was like pushing the stroller down to the recording studio.
It's very rock and roll.
So, oh, it's totally rock and roll. I had her set up in the pack and play out in the next room. She's standing there like, what's going on in there?
Although I've said it before and I'll say it again, that is a great way to pick up chicks. You come in with a kid, number one, you're safe. It's like, oh, baby, yeah, yeah, yeah. Nobody's going to be like, yo, get away from me. It's beautiful. You know, I tell guys, listen, borrow somebody's baby, go to the fucking park, all right? Once you nail the chick, you know, you firm up dinner plans or whatever, and then it's like, oh, well, it's not my kid, I'm just babysitting. They still think you're sweet because you took the afternoon. You know what I mean? It's way better than a puppy.
Yeah.
I mean, a human kid, there's nothing. I mean, when my kids were little and I'd be like walking through the mall, I'd thinking, now all the pussy's all over me, you know? Like, what happened before? I'm the same dude. I just got a baby in my hand. Oh, well, you're safe now. We know. We're not going to fuck you. So.
It's almost poetic.
Yeah, it really is. It really is.
So that was 2009. It was like a bunch of writing, and then we accelerated the recording process kind of insanely. It was like, gotta get this done. We just gotta get this. The time is now, and now is the time. And our second record is a much more drawn out.
And we've been since then working on the second record, which is about a quarter done at this point, I would say, or something like that.
But we love it. We love everything about it. It was, I was trying to think whether it was something you brought up there. Well, just between, I think that soon after, so we were, this was on tour. It was Andrew and Chris and I all on tour together. And then we got done with the tour at New Year's. And then I went to the NAMM show, and I had only met Jason a couple of times.
Mm-hmm.
If that. Maybe I had just been told about him by Chris. And I get to the NAMM show, and Jason is there, and I run into him, and I say, you're Jason Gianni. He's like, yeah. I was like, you're in my band. He's like, I am? I was like, yeah. Didn't Chris talk to you about it? You're gonna do this Daredevil Squadron with us. Like, it's, you know, and he was like, okay. And I was like, done. And that was it. So I was kind of like, I let him know that he had the gig.
Well, whatever works.
Yeah.
And so, the lineup has stayed the same, correct?
It has. We had to the bass chair has gone into flux a little bit over the last year due to, there's been availability issues. Chris lived part of the year in Pennsylvania, spent some time in Europe. So we've done a few gigs where we used a couple of different guys as Merlin, mm-hmm. to continue the Top Gun reference. So whoever subs on the bass chair gets the call sign Merlin. So we've used a couple of really great bass players, old friends that are able to cut the material. So.
Now the band is New York City based?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. And Angus, where are you from?
New York City, born and raised.
All right. Right here in Manhattan?
Yep. I live in Brooklyn now.
Nice. Whereabouts in Manhattan were you born and raised?
Upper West Side.
Whereabouts? I live up there.
110th of Riverside.
I'm about, I don't want to give it away to my crazy ass fucking listeners, they'll all be stalking my place, but same neighborhood. Same neighborhood. So you can all just come to Riverside and go to 110 and just keep fucking walking around, and maybe you'll run into me. Yeah, it's nice up there though, man. You were born and raised up there?
Yep.
Wow. Yeah. I live right on Riverside, man. It's fucking nice. I love it up there. I'm happy. Happy camper.
It's nice. Nice part of
all right, and you know my listeners, I'm just fucking with you. You know that. You can come over anytime you want, if you can find me. All right, listen, we're gonna do another track from this, and I gotta tell you, this is my favorite track off the album. Because I listened to this a good probably 10 times between last night and tonight, the whole album, and I said, this fucking song right here does it for me. I'm just gonna put it on. And then we're going to talk about it afterwards. Punishment fits. That is right up my fucking alley as to what kind of shit I like. Now, yes. What was the influence for that song?
That's about
You mean lyrically or
well, no, lyrically is where it's at. Yeah, I got a feeling it's got something to do with a chick.
It's about taking your lumps.
About taking your lumps. Is that what it is?
If I gotta sleep on the couch, it better be worth it.
Yeah.
That's basically.
So it's really like a guy girl type of.
It's totally like I got in trouble, and you know I'm gonna have to do my time. But so long as it was worth it, I'm all good.
It's about life choices, really.
Yeah. and bad ones, obviously. Or there'd be no song Punishment Fits.
Yeah.
It is very literal in most of the verses, I think. You
but
know?
I like the way you took, you know, the bad. You must have been at the end of the couch one night and go, you know what, fuck this. I got it. Punishment Fits, right? So it was great inspiration. It was more than worth the trouble because you got a great song out of it.
I think that there were, you know, I think there were definitely conversations, you know, had between various members of the band that led to, you know, this, a lot of this specific lyrical material. And I'm not going to say who particularly may have experienced some of these, you know, travails in their relationships. I'm not going to point any fingers, but definitely we've all been through some version of it. And, you know, it's kind of one of those things like in this song, you know, our hero in this song is taking it for granted that he's not going to wind up single at the end of this situation. He's going to take some lumps, but he's still going to wind up, you know, in the relationship he started out in, but he may have misbehaved on more than one occasion. That's kind of
sounds that way. All right. Now, you just gave me a great segue for Hero, because the song Hero Falls is another song that I really, really like off this CD. Gonna talk about this a little bit before we play it, and then some questions afterwards. You tell me, but I notice, and I want the listeners to hear this too, a definite sort of Thin Lizzy type intro.
Absolutely.
Coming in.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And the lyrics in this song, very, very interesting. I want to talk about that after we play the song. So you're in the studio, Rock Hard, with Jay Conroy, in the studio with DareDevil Squadron on RockHardRadio1.com from New York City. We're going to do Hero Falls. We'll see you on the other side of that.
You pray for money, you pray for love. You pray for something to believe in, with your Bible and your comic books. Who you think you've been deceiving? You wanna know how the story goes, like that tale of brave Ulysses. He got brought down by the siren sound, his wife.
Babe, don't you miss me?
It's all there in a hero's tale.
To believe in, he tells the truth, he's bulletproof, keeps the sides nice and even. Do you wanna know how the story goes? Well, you know he had to blow it. He lost a fight to Kryptonite. Now he sits at home with Lois. It's all there in a hero's tale. They're only human after all. It's all fair.
takes her time, cuts you a line, says you're looking kind of tired. You thought you knew just what you do, now you're jacked up and wired. You wanna know how the story ends? Well, hey man, I've been there before. You lose your shack, get a heart attack, you better head for the door. It's like I told you before, you better head for the door. It's all there in a hero's tale. They're only human after all. It's all fair in a hero's tale. Your hero come and your hero fall. It's all fair in a hero's tale. They're only human after all. It's all fair in a hero's tale. Your hero come and your hero fall. Hey, hey, hey. Hey, hey, hey.
Another rocker, screaming fucking guitars, you two.
Thank you.
Screaming, man. I love a two-guitar band. Now, during that song, I said, listen, I'm going to ask you about something, and it was the whole cocaine reference. Tell me about that.
Well, this song is mostly about flawed men that are brought down by wicked women. And in that particular verse, the guy is being offered some hard drugs by a loose woman. And what's the line? It's like, she takes her time, cuts you a line, says you're looking kind of tired.
Right.
But then to flip that on its head, the line is, you want to know how the story ends, you lose your shack and get a heart attack, you better head for the door. So basically, you know, you're in this situation, it might sound good right now, but it's not going to work out for you if you go ahead and...
So what I'm getting here is you guys have dated a lot of fucked up chicks. However, it's made for great rock and roll now, hasn't
yes,
it?
Yes, it's all research. It's all in the name of research,
it
Jay.
It is all.
Let's just say that I spent a good amount of time in the East Village in the 90s and, you know, dated girls that may have, you know, gotten me into certain compromising situations, and it all came out in the lyrics. But, you know, Aurelian, why don't you weigh in on what this is about?
Well, I was about, in the 90s, I was 10. So, I don't want to date anyone here or anything
man,
like
these
that.
Bus wheels are heavy on my
you
back.
Know, but, so I didn't have that
They're
problem.
They're leaving marks, man.
But from all those, you know, History Channel documentaries that I've seen about the East Village in the 90s, and, you know, next to a, you
was
know,
he in any
dinosaur documentary.
You see
and,
Angus in a crowd
prehistory.
Anywhere?
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah. You know, I thought so.
Yeah.
He looked so young, it's hard to tell.
Yeah.
Man, it's
he was
all...
a guy sleeping on a couch in an alley with a spoon.
That was
a cold
him.
Spoon.
Yeah, yeah.
It's all out there, Jay. Come on, you just read between the lines. You get a little taste.
But you know,
I just, like it.
It just seems like that's what happens. That's what happened then and
yeah.
there. You know, and that was how life was. For better or worse.
That was an interesting time. I mean, I don't know, Jay, you're probably familiar with this period I'm talking about, but you know, there was
No, I was only 10 in the 90s right. too.
I just brought it up with a friend of mine. I was talking to another friend of mine about, I don't know, there was some reference to a band that he was in that was signed back then, and there were a bunch of bands that were signed out of New York in the 90s, a lot of RCA signings and BMG distribution, and a lot of them went nowhere. Like, a lot of those bands went nowhere. But a lot of them had big advances, and there were a lot of drugs on the street in the 90s. Like, heroin had made its resurgence.
Yeah,
that was,
especially
that,
downtown.
That
yeah.
stuff had hit back again, and a lot of guys wound up dead
yeah.
in New York and elsewhere. But, you know, I know some guys that didn't make it out of that period of time. So it's a... It was interesting watching, you know, the record business fund you know, these guys who were set up to go absolutely no place, and then they just spent their advance money on, you know, went up their arms, and they wound up, you know, casualties of the whole situation. And, you know, I mean, I was in it and not, you know, the band I was in luckily got dropped right away. So it wasn't like I had any advance to spend on anything.
Right. You're better off.
So, you know, we all made it out alive and lived to tell the stories. And so there's one.
Well, you know, back in the 70s, it was well documented that the record companies would bury money for coke in the budgets because they did not care. They just wanted the album done. And I'm a big Aerosmith fan, and in one of their documentaries, their producer Jack Douglas talks about it, and he comes right out and says it. He says the labels would just bury all the cocaine in the budget that we wanted because they just wanted the record done. So they didn't really give a fuck about the band, you know,
right.
Or maybe it's a little different than thinking, well, coke's not going to fucking kill them, you know, or whatever, but that's exactly what it was. It's like, yeah, oh, they're not done yet. Bring them more coke. You know, keep them going. Keep them going.
It's what it was, the undoing of Casablanca Records. I mean, I don't know if you
coke,
read, if you read Hitmen, but, you know, that was like...
Oh, so, yeah. Good book.
Great book.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, anyway, yeah, there's a lot of... there's a lot of nefarious activity in and around the music industry. That was just my take. A little cautionary tale there. It's, you know, not saying anybody needs to go out and experience it themselves.
No. You know, and I know, Aurelian, when we were talking about cats like Doug Aldrich,
yeah,
and Rudy Sarzo, to name a couple. And I noticed with these guys, and you know, these guys are not that young. Those guys are in their 50s, easy, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed with those guys, the longevity seems to be with them staying in peak physical shape. I mean, you look at those guys. They're fucking cut. You know what I mean? It looks like they've gone to the gym and shit like that. But you got to figure at their age, if they were just partying, 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 they'd be dead or burnt out or over by now. So it almost seems to me that at some point they go, okay, if I'm going to continue this in this touring, especially at the level that you know, they tour, which is not extreme high money levels, you know, for a lot of them. And, you know, I guess somewhere they made a turn and said, you know, if we're going to keep doing this, we got to stay in shape. It's the only way. Because you know what being on the road is like.
Yeah.
You know, it's a bitch, man. It beats the shit out of you. So, you know, maybe that's the new way to do things. And, you know, because the coke's only going to take you, you know, it's like I always say, drugs work. For a while.
I think that, you know, the model that you're seeing guys like, I mean, look, Doug Aldrich is an amazing player. That's a talented guy, and everything that he's had come his way, you know, particularly in the last decade, you know, he's already a veteran player, but he's kind of seeing like his time at the top, you know, as a more mature player, you know, and you're also seeing these guys, you know, it shows in their guitar playing, man, they're making, you know, better choices. Like, look, I might have had, you know, better technical chops right out of college or something like that, or when I was, you know, listening to nothing but Yngwie Malmsteen records and stuff like that, but I'm much happier with my playing on the DareDevil Squadron record, where you kind of, I've had the time to you know, relax and really let things show. And, you know, Aurelian and I met teaching, right?
That's right.
Teaching guitar.
Teaching
obviously.
Guitar, yes.
Yeah. And I just learn a lot by being in a band with him. He's got so much facility and so many different... There's so many different angles on his skill set that are different than mine that I'm able to gain a lot out of. We're just all learning all the time. And clean living, you know, is just part of being prepared for what comes your way in terms of career choices. Like, if we get offered opportunities and stuff like that, you have to be prepared. You have to be in shape. You
right.
can't be messing with, struggling with your demons when, you know, when the opportunity comes knocking. You have to be ready to take the opportunity.
That's a good point. That's a very good point. Now, speaking of, you're talking to Yngwie and stuff like that, what are your guys' most early influences? When you were, Aurelien, when you were a little kid, and you're from France,
yes,
correct?
That's right.
When you were in France, and let's say you were like 10, 12 years old, what did you start hearing on the radio or from friends with records or whatever? What got you into rock and roll, and what were your early influences?
Well, believe it or not, but the guitar player that first inspired me to pick up guitar and is still, you know, one of my heroes to this day is Mark Knopfler from the band Dire Straits.
Interesting.
Yes, and I love this band, and I still do, and I think they're, you know, they wrote some incredible shit, you know, and his playing, I still listen to some of those old records, and you know, like all of their records, they don't have that many records as it turns out, but yeah. It's just, it's mind-blowing, you know, because his facility and his feel and his, you know, he's so understated all the time, or most of the time, and when I was hearing that as a kid, my parents were playing that on the stereo, you know, I must have been, you know, 7, 8 or something. For some reason, that really spoke to me. And that's really what, you know, got me wanting to play the guitar and really inspired me to start taking music seriously, even at a very young age.
So when you went out, you got your first guitar. Did you start learning Dire Straits?
Yeah. That's all I wanted to do at first, mm-hmm. you know, because I didn't know a whole lot of music, you know. But as I started, you know, learning some chords and learning some Dire Straits song, and you know, little by little, and growing up, I started guitar when I was 9, you know. So I didn't know a lot of bands then, but as you grow up.
As you grew up, who did you start getting into after Dire Straits?
So Dire Straits was big for a while, and then once I got a guitar teacher, he kind of exposed me to a lot of guitar players, and a big period for me was Joe Satriani.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Great player. Yeah, yeah. I studied a lot of his stuff when I was, you know, like 11, 12, 13, and all the... You know, all the guitar players in that vein, you know, Joe Satriani and Steve Vai were the big two.
Yes, they were the big two.
You know, I still love listening to them today, and I try to go check them out when they're in town. And
they tour pretty frequently.
Yeah. They're around. But growing up in France, it was kind of a big event to have them come to France. And most of the time they would play in Paris, and I grew up in Bordeaux, which is, you know, a smaller town, and they would never come play. And when they did come and play, that was like if the Pope was coming, you know what I mean?
Because
all the music scene would come out, and it was just bananas, you know? It was just everybody was so charged up, and even I think they were surprised that many people showed up and that everybody was so... loud, you know, because everybody was so excited to see them, you know. So now, you know, I've been living in New York for a while, and you know, of course, whenever they tour, they stop by New York, and so I still try to go because my inner, you know, early teenager growing up in France is like, you know, it's like I wish I had that opportunity back then to be able to see them live as much as I'm able to now, you know. So that's you know, nostalgia for sure, but that was a big part of my my musical growth back then.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Angus, what about you?
Oh, just two points on what Aurelien said. One was Mark Knopfler is an amazing inspiration to me. Love Over Gold, The Telegraph Road.
Yes.
Just kills me. As songwriting... as well as guitar players.
Yes,
just
yes.
The very
amazing, you know, songwriter.
Yeah,
amazing.
Lyrically, what he was doing. In terms of what happened to you when you were 13, you know, you can't fight it. Like you,
right
now, it doesn't matter where we go or what we do, man. The stuff that hit us at that point and like indelibly marks us for the rest of our career as musicians. So for the
I
rest
agree.
Of your life, there's nothing you can do about it. You can't fight what happened to you at that point, you know, musically.
Yeah.
And
formative years.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Yeah. Right. And
completely.
And so it sticks in your ear too. You know, it's like people when they study guitar and stuff like that, they're so interested in what they're supposed to do with their hands. And I'm like, you're supposed to do whatever it takes with your hands to make it sound right to your ear, you know, and you will do that.
Right.
Like if you're letting your ear guide you, you will eventually figure out the right way to make those sounds. And so for me, the first guys were David Gilmour and Tony Iommi. Those were the two first guys. And then, you know, everybody that came in the wake of that, because the guys who were making records at that point, you know, The Wall came out, Sabbath were on to like the Ronnie James Dio lineup, so right. It was like Mob Rules and Heaven and Hell. And then Ozzy came out, so it was Randy, you know what I mean? So
yeah.
It was like Tony and David Gilmour, and then Randy and Michael Schenker, and, you know, and then, you know, all that stuff was happening. And then there was Yngwie, and then there was, you know, like, the whole interest in that stratty tone and all that stuff, you know, led to guys like Mark Knopfler, and then, you know, there's whole periods where I was digging deep just on Hendrix and Clapton and, you know, all, you know, now, you know, Aurelian, if Aurelian is, I'm sure, the same, you know, we had those periods
right.
where you just opened it right up and you were deep in
exactly.
it. But the Chops guys that hit me, it was more Randy and Yngwie, and I consider Schenker like one of the highly technical guys, although I don't know, probably if you put him up against these other guys in terms of actual notes per second, he's not probably on the shred level with these other cats, but he was like a highly technical thing. And I've watched all videos of him where he doesn't use his pinky. I'm like, how the hell is he, you know, it's like
Yngwie, you can say fuck on
you
the
know
show.
Yngwie's using his pinky, you know, but Schenker just three fingers a lot of the time. So that was it, you know. And Gilmour and Iommi are field players, you know, man. They're not the big technical guys, but at that time, the 80s, you know, you just had to get all that fast stuff together.
Yeah, well, a couple of things is, the technical part for me is not where it's at. It's more about the feel. You know, you said something about, you know, notes per second, and I'm the kind of guy, well, I'm not as interested in notes per second as I am about the song as a whole, you know, but I'm not a guitar player, so, you know. Randy Rhoads, I remember when Randy, excuse me, joined Ozzy, and I'm reading everywhere, like, you know, Ozzy's got this guy, Randy Rhoads, this guy's fucking incredible, blah, blah, blah. So I go to see him at a Nassau Coliseum, and I couldn't fucking believe how good he was. You know, it was incredible. And I got to see him one more time before he died, and it was like, damn, man, you know? Unbelievable.
I'm jealous right there. I actually had tickets to see him on the Diary of Madman tour at the Garden. And
I think that was the other show I saw.
He died. They postponed the show, I think. Or maybe it went on schedule. I don't remember. But it was... And by the time they did it, he had Bernie Torme. So it was like two shows that Bernie Torme played, and then Brad Gillis got the gig.
I still have the program from when I went. Yeah, I would save all that stuff.
I mean, I remember I had maybe just gotten the record and had found out what was going on, and I remember everybody saying, oh, I'm going to see him tonight at the Palladium. And
yeah.
Like that Palladium 1982 footage from the Palladium is like there's some really bad quality footage.
You know what?
Now
that I think about it, that
now.
Was the first show because it was, I remember, Ozzy Osbourne's Blizzard of Oz. Out there on the fucking marquee. So, yes, I was at that
show. You went to the Palladium show. I am jealous. I
went to the Palladium show, and then I saw a triple bill with, let me get this right, it was Ozzy, Def Leppard, and the Joe Perry Project right after he left Aerosmith.
Let the music do the talking.
Yeah. And that was the second time that I saw Randy Rhoads, so... And the last. So there's the two. I had my dates mixed up, but...
What was funny about Bernie Torme was that he was getting actively booed by the crowd.
Right, that's what I heard.
The show. And he was playing a white Strat. And what's so funny is that he's a British, very Ritchie Blackmore-inspired kind of player. Like, totally other school. And some Hendrix kind of stuff. And I'm totally skipped Blackmore in my list of influences just then. And Blackmore's another guy that I cannot escape. Like his the Rainbow.
Yeah, stuff I love was, Blackmore.
For me, it was just awesome. But like he, I just you know remember this the whole thing of just hating on this guy so terribly, and then in retrospect, I'm like, poor mother. Poor guy.
Just, oh, know. Yeah, I know. I mean like, you get the you call.
Know,
you don't
Sharon is like, get somebody. Right. And, you know.
You get the call. You can't say no to that. Right. But at the same time, you're stepping in to going, oh, my God, you know, 20,000 people that love this Randy Rhoads yeah. guy who was tragically fucking killed. Everything's working against me here.
No yeah. matter who you are, no matter how yeah. good. You know, it's you can't. Yeah, yeah. You can't win that
no,
one.
No, you
know?
Can't win.
Yeah.
All right, I want to do another song from the album. This is another song that I really, really like. We're going to talk about this on the other side. Once again, you're listening to Rock Hard with Jay Conroy on RockHardRadio1.com from New York City. In the studio, Angus and Ariellen from DareDevil Squadron joining us, going through some tunes. We're going to do a song that I really like off the album. It's called Forgotten Son.
I'm dealing this round and there's only one.
Forgotten Sun by DareDevil Squadron. We were talking during the song. You guys were telling me that was actually the first track that you cut.
Maybe not the first one we cut, but definitely the first one we wrote. I remember Angus sending me a demo of this song, which was pretty much, very close to the final version. And we went into the rehearsal studio and changed a couple of things, a couple of details here and there, but the original demo that he sent me with Andrew on vocals as well, if I remember correctly, is pretty much there.
Yeah, this was all we were all on the road, Chris, Andrew, and I, and we just started doing it with laptops and drum loop libraries or garage band loops and stuff, and playing little portable studio action. But the thing that's very Iron Maiden about this is the one that's very deliberately Iron Maiden inspired.
Yes.
And it's like a songwriting exercise that you do this when you're just working on your songwriting craft. You take the storyline from an existing song and you rewrite it. So this is essentially the storyline from Wrathchild. So this
okay.
is like I'm taking the storyline from Iron Maiden Wrathchild and rewrote it as this song, Forgotten Son. So it's a song about, an abandoned kid who seeks vengeance on his parent. And it basically just rewrote that storyline as this song. And there's certain things in the musical arrangement that are, kind of odes to that song as well. I think there's a whole segment in the guitar solos where we do that modulating motion that's very similar to is it Wrathchild or is it? I don't know. It's like an amalgamation of Phantom of the Opera and Wrathchild and three other songs on the Killers album. So it's anyway, it was a lot of fun to do it just kind of as a project, and we were so happy with what came out that we were like, all right, we've got a band, we're doing this.
All right, another song that I like on here, because I'm trying to get through, you guys got so much stuff and you got guitar, so I'm hoping that we can get you to play a little bit. Now, I know I sound a little bit off mic tonight, but there's a reason for that. It's so you can hear my guests better, because people have accused me of saying, oh, he turns his mic up and turns the guest mic down so he sounds louder and more authoritative. No, that's not the fucking case whatsoever, okay? So this time I moved this mic really, really close to them. So if I sound off mic, that's why. But you all are used to hearing me talk anyway, so you'll get over that part. So that's why if it sounds shitty, as far as I do, don't worry about it.
Jay is all love, by the way.
Yeah, I'm all love. I'm all love. All right, another song I want to do is, hang on. Here we go. It's called Faith, Hope, Love. Check this song out.
Too close, you'll see. When I let him out, he's got a real long chain. I learned the rules long time ago. You want the truth? Go figure it out. I'll do.
and it gets harder in the night. Wait till dark and see if your spark I might ignite. I learned the rules a long time ago. You want the truth?
All right, DareDevil Squadron, New York City, hard, heavy band. Check these guys out. That was a great interview. So great, we're going to be doing part two next week, all right? Almost time for us to get out of here, but before we do, I want to say thank you very, very much for listening to Rock Hard with Jay Conroy on RockHardRadio1.com. Also want to remind you that the station rocks 24/7, so you can rock out anytime you want. And if you want to hear the show again, check the website because the show does replay for different time zones. And once again, thank you so very much. Got time for one more song. I will see you next week. Rock hard.